dear colleagues, this course of lectures is designed for English-speaking students who study human anatomy at high school medical faculties. These lectures were created in the traditions of Russian School of Anatomy and in accordance with Program on Human Anatomy for Medical Faculties in the Russian Federation. One of the features of the course is obligatory requirement of knowledge of the Latin terminology. We wish you success in your studies.
Columna vertebralis. Vertebra. The vertebral column, columna vertebralis in Latin, or the spinal column, the spine, has a metameric structure and consists of separate bone segments, vertebrae, placed one over another in a series. They are short, spongy bones. What is the function of the spine? The spine acts as axial skeleton supporting the body. It protects the spinal cord enclosed in its canal and takes part in movements of the trunk and the head. The position and shape of the vertebral column are determined by the upright position of man. The vertebral column consists of 34 vertebrae, the intervertebral discs, and a number of ligaments. The vertebrae consist of 7 cervical vertebrae in the neck, 12 thoracic vertebrae in the chest, 5 lumbar vertebrae, loins, 5 fused sacral vertebrae, the sacrum, 4 or 5 coccygeal vertebrae, coccyx. The designation of the vertebra. MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, is one of the anatomical methods of medical imaging. The individual vertebrae are often designated by a shorthand notation as follows: C7 for the 7th cervical vertebra, T2 for the 2nd thoracic vertebra, L1 for the 1st lumbar vertebra, S1 for the 1st sacral vertebra, the 24 vertebrae above the sacrum are called true or presacral vertebrae, forming the true spinal column. In the adult, they attain a length of 55-63 centimeters, or 35% of the body's height. The sacral and coccygeal vertebrae are fused and form the sacrum and the coccyx, tailbone. In this picture, you can see the designation of the vertebrae on the back of the woman. Now let us study vertebrae itself. Common features of the vertebrae. In accordance with the three functions of the spine, each vertebra has the following features. An anterior part, which is responsible for support, the vertebral body, or corpus vertebrae in Latin. An arch, arcus vertebrae in Latin, which is attached to the posterior surface of the body and contributes to the formation of the foramen vertebrae. A series of these foramina forms the vertebral canal, which protects the spinal cord lodged in it from external injury. The vertebral arch, therefore, primarily fulfills a protective function. The arch also carries structures permitting movement of the vertebra called processes. A spinal process arises from the arch on the midline. A transverse processes project laterally on each side. Paired superior and inferior articular processes project upward and downward. Structure of a typical vertebra. Vertebrae have a common basic shape that change in the different segments of the spinal column to adapt to their various static needs. Here it is a typical lumbar vertebra, a view from above and from the right side. Every vertebra, with the exception of the first cervical, atlas, has a body, or corpus vertebrae in Latin, number 1 in this picture, an arch, arcus vertebrae in Latin, number 2, and 7 processes. A spine, processus spinosus in Latin, number 3. 2 transverse processes, processus transversus in Latin, number 4. And 4 articular processes, processus articularis, number 5, with articular facets on them, facies articularis, in Latin, number 5a. The vertebral body and the arch enclose the vertebral foramen, in Latin, foramen vertebrae, number 6. All the vertebral foramina together form the vertebral canal, which houses the spinal cord. You can see the spinal cord inside the vertebral canal in magnetic resonance image. The spinal cord placed inside the vertebral canal. Structure of the vertebra. Corresponding to increasing load, the size of the vertebrae increases from above down. Every vertebral arch at its origin from the vertebral body is marked above and below by notch. Incisura vertebralis in Latin. Incisura vertebralis superior et incisura vertebralis inferior. The notches of two adjoining vertebrae form the intervertebral foramen, in Latin foramen intervertebrale. Foramen intervertebrale transmits the spinal nerves. Let's look at the types of the vertebrae. First of all, vertebrae cervicalis. The first cervical vertebra is called atlas. The designation C1. The second cervical vertebra is called axis. The designation C2. Other cervical vertebrae do not have specific names. What are distinctive features of the cervical vertebrae? First of all, they have foramen transversarium. It's important that all the seven cervical vertebrae have foramen transversarium. Processus spinosus is bifid, but only from C2 to C6. The first cervical vertebrae and the second cervical vertebrae are atypical. Atypical cervical vertebrae. Atlas, the first cervical vertebra. View from above. Number one in this picture is Tuberculum anterius atlantis, and number two, Tuberculum posterius atlantis. You can see that Atlas has no body. That's why, instead of the body, there is number three, Arcus anterior atlantis. Number four is Arcus posterior atlantis. They are connected with number five, Massa lateralis atlantis. And number six, this is Facies articularis superior atlantis. Number seven, Processus transversus atlantis. And number eight, Foramen transversarium atlantis. Number nine, Fovea dentis atlantis. Number ten, Foramen vertebrae. Number 11, Ligamentum transversum atlantis. And now axis, view from above. Number one, dense axis, the remnant of the body of Atlas. Number two, facies articularis anterior. Number three, processus articularis superior. Number four, arcus vertebrae. Number five, processus spinosus. Number six, foramen vertebrae. And now, vertebrae thoracice. Thoracic vertebrae. These are four superior thoracic vertebrae. Four middle thoracic vertebrae. And inferior four thoracic vertebrae. What are distinctive characteristics of thoracic vertebrae? Corpus vertebrae has one or two costal facets for articulation with head of the rib. The next processus transversus of thoracic vertebrae is long. Its length diminishes from first thoracic vertebra to 12 thoracic vertebra. Vertebrae from first thoracic to the 10th thoracic have transverse costal facets for articulation of the first to the 10th ribs. Eleventh and 12th ribs have no tubercle and do not articulate with a transverse process. And now an example of typical thoracic vertebra. This is 6th thoracic vertebra view from the left side. Number 1 the corpus vertebrae. Number 2, fovea costalis superior. Number 3, processus articularis superior. Number 4, fovea costalis processus transversi. Number 5, incisura vertebralis inferior. Number 6, fovea costalis inferior. Number 7, processus articularis inferior. Number 8, processus spinosus. And now, vertebrae lumbalis, lumbar vertebrae. There are 5 lumbar vertebrae. What are the distinctive features of the lumbar vertebrae? First of all, absence of signs of cervical vertebrae, foramen transversarium, and thoracic vertebrae, fovea costalis. And also, there is processus accessorius on posterior surface of base of each processus transversus. The next feature, processus mammillaris on posterior surface of each processus articularis superior. The next segment of columna vertebralis, vertebrae sacralis et coccygia, os sacrum et coccyx sacral and coccygeal region of vertebral column. Here it is, os sacrum, facies pelvica or facies anterior. Number one, basis ossis sacri. At number two, apex ossis sacri. The bodies of the five sacral vertebrae are demarcated in the mature sacrum by four transverse lines. In Latin, they called linea transversa, which end laterally in four pairs of foramina sacralia pelvina. Here you can see sacrum in youth. You can see that sacrum in youth consists of five separate vertebrae. The coccyx has four vertebrae. The first coccygeal vertebra has a pair of transverse processes. And here it is, sacrum et coccyx, from the back. That means we can see here facies dorsalis ossis sacri or facies posterior ossis sacri. Number one here, facies articularis superior. It serves for articulation with fifth lumbar vertebrae. Number two, facies auricularis. It serves for articulation with hip bone. Number three, crista sacralis mediana. It's remnant of fused processus spinosus vertebra sacralis. And number four, crista sacralis lateralis. It's a remnant of fused processus transversus. Number five, foramina sacralia dorsalia. Number six, tuberositas sacralis. It serves to attach ligaments and muscles. Number seven, canalis sacralis, contains spinal radices. And number eight, hiatus sacralis. And now, very interesting issue concerning the spine as a whole. Spinal curvature. Although the spine is a vertical column, it is not straight but curved in sagittal plane. The curvatures, curvatures in the thoracic and sacral parts are posteriorly convex, while those in cervical and lumbar segments are anteriorly convex. A curvature posteriorly convex is called kyphosis, and arteriorly convex curvature is called lordosis. So, in the erect posture, the spinal column in the adult forms a double S curvature in the sagittal plane with T two anteriorly oriented convexities, cervical lordosis and lumbar lordosis, and two posteriorly oriented concavities, thoracic kyphosis and sacral kyphosis. Now, let me ask you, what is lordosis? Lordosis is anteriorly oriented convexity of spinal column. And what is kyphosis? Kyphosis is posteriorly oriented convexity of spinal column. This arrangement creates a flexible rod with elastic springiness that is especially fitted to cushion axial or vertical loads during running and jumping. What is scoliosis? Scoliosis is pathological lateral curvature of the spinal column. It's interesting that spine of newborn is almost straight with slight primary curvatures, thoracic kyphosis and sacral kyphosis. When the infant begins to raise his head, the cervical lordosis forms, and when child learns to stand and to walk, the main curvature, the lumbar lordosis, forms.